Thank you, Greg. Mike, thanks for the opportunity to talk a little bit about Sentosa. And am I getting this right? Some reason, here we go. And the topic Mike and I talked about was taking local global to present today. When you think about Sentosa Golf Club, you know, we're 46 years old. And it's really only been in the past 10, 12 years that we've made that leap into a global market and a brand that's recognized around the world. And so he challenged me to come talk a little bit about that. So what I'm going to talk a little bit about is our strategies and some of the things that we've done to make that work. But before I get there, I just want to share. I am going to talk about some trade names. I will talk about some things that work for us, but I'm not trying to sell anything. I'm not trying to represent anybody. I'm just going to talk innocently about the things that work at Sentosa Golf Club and why we use them and how we use them in just kind of an educational manner. A bit about my background. I've been a golf course superintendent. I've also practiced as a golf course architect for many years, and a construction project manager. And I think these three fields really helped me become well-rounded for the assignment of being a GM of Sentosa Golf Club. Strategies that I'm gonna talk about is our culture. It's really about our people, because it really starts there. It's with our people that we really wanna drive a good culture. And so when I talk about cultures, I look at NASA. And what could NASA do for us? And one of the great stories that came out of NASA was in 1962 when President Kennedy went to go visit NASA. And when he was doing the tour of the facility, he ran into a janitor and he asked the janitor, "What are you doing?" And the janitor looked at him and said, "Well, Mr. President, I'm helping put a man on the moon." Well, how important is that everybody within that organization knew what their strategy was, and they knew what their end goal was? And so defining a culture for workplace strategy is extremely important, because everybody within your organization, no matter how big or small their role is contributing to that story. And I would hope if you come to our club and you ask anybody at our club what they were doing, they wouldn't say, "Well, I've got 15 minutes till my break," or "I'm sweeping the floor." I'd hope they'd say, "We're trying to present a golf course in tournament condition," because this is our mission. When the entire team embraces this type of attitude, this unconditional belief in the system, this is when incredible things can happen. And so really, again, it's about culture. One of the things I like to use from Forbes: if you're not a leader on the bench, don't call yourself a leader on the field. You're a leader everywhere and nowhere. A good example of that is when I first came to Sentosa, and I was sitting at the GT with some of my other colleagues. Our executive chef had just bought a really nice new pastry refrigerator that we put out on the floor. And he positioned it in a way where it blocked the cash register from the floor, so the person sitting behind it couldn't see the floor. And I said to my colleagues, I said, "He's got it in the wrong spot." And my colleague looked at me and said, "Stay out of it, it's not your business." Absolutely the wrong thing to say. It is all of our business, because as all of us as HODs or leaders or GMs, we all have to find a way to work together to make sure that story works. For those of you who know me, know that I will not tolerate toxic talk in our workplace. If you have that going on, if you've got, you know, employees talking about each other, or talking about managers, or middle managers talking about the higher level, there's no way you're going to take your organization to a global level. And workplace really needs to be a safe place for everybody. So, as GM, isn't it your responsibility to make sure that that's aligned all the way through the organization, from the board level, ownership level, committee, your stakeholders, and then your staff? So the difference between being a manager and a leader You know, having a good culture in your workplace does develop leaders. Managers do things right. Leaders do the right things. It's a big difference between the two. So it's best to be both, a manager and a leader. But as a leader, it's your job to inspire your people, to push themselves and in turn the company to greatness. And to do this, you must show them the way. Because if you give yourself to your team, most likely they'll follow you anywhere. So driving a workplace culture is truly important when you're talking about taking your organization to a global level and then trying to sustain that. And that has to work with your entire HOD team. When I first arrived, that didn't work. Our agronomy team couldn't get along with golfing. There was divisions there. They didn't even like to talk. Our golfing team and our F&B team had conflicts, all under the same house. That can't work. It's got to be like the fire department, all for one, one for all. We have to work together no matter what the goal is, no matter what the task is, and no matter what our specialty is. We have to work together to make sure that we conquer the goal. Now, I think at every organization, the most important person at any golf course is the golf course superintendent. It's not the GM, it's nobody, it's the golf course superintendent. Because if you don't have a good golf course, you've got nothing to sell. You have a real problem. But I also think it's extremely important to surround your golf course superintendent with the best talent you can find. So our executive chef, who we recently put on board, KK, he's also the manager of the Singapore culinary team. He'll take the culinary team later this month to the Singapore Olympics, to the World Olympics for culinary. 4 years ago, when the culinary Olympics happened, Singapore won. So he's got some pretty big shoes to fill to hopefully bring it back. But I think it's just as important that we offer as many superstars on that HOD team as possible. And you know something's going right in your workplace, take team pitchers. And the team pitcher, everybody looks like they want to be there. Nobody looks like they're watching the clock. They all look like they enjoy what they're doing because they really do. And they look up to the people that they work with. So living our values and hospitality, corporate responsibility really comes from within. And how does your culture define your touch points? These are our 11 touch points. What does our car park look like? How's the bag drop look like? How are you greeted when you approach our golf reception? All of your culture defines what those things look like. Our operation strategy can be summed up in these three things. Our mission, tournament ready 365, deliver Asia's best golf experience, a pretty big vision, but it's something that we aspire to try and do. And then our objective, this is not a practice round, the tournament is today. That is on the wall at golf maintenance. You can't not get to the golf course without driving by that. It is on the wall in our members' car park. When they all arrive, they see it. It's on the wall next to where every employee clocks in when they show up to work. It's impossible not to know what our strategy is. It's impossible to know that what we're trying to deliver is a tournament-conditioned golf course 365 days out of the year. It's not a practice round. We're trying to do it every day. And we've adopted a fourth pillar, and that fourth pillar defines our environmental responsibility. So it's a campaign we started this year called Keep It Green, and the green logo of Sentosa, that reflection of our Keep It Green campaign. The journey that we took that really defines the global brand that we've grown into started when we renovated the golf course. Originally designed by Ron Freem and the Golf Plan guys. In 2006, we made that decision to invest in our asset into the Serapong course. And this was me in 2006 when it was my assignment, when I worked with the Bates Group testing the distance to the landing area. And during that renovation, we made the commitment, which was our initial milestone event, shaped the immediate and long-term master plan goals. This marked our commitment to invest in processes, people, and technology. It's a vision and a commitment that we've never stopped pursuing. When we went through renovation, We took on things like Sub-Air, upgraded the equipment package. We introduced fans, fans that were normally seen in cool season places, wireless soil sensors, an intelligent fertigation system, added improved grass species, bunker strategy, and improved irrigation system. When we went through the redesign, we took things like, this is hole 14, and it was a par 3 that had a concrete cart path that crossed in front of the green. And if you had a poor shot that hit the cart path and bounced on the green, you were rewarded for a poor shot. And so we put that serpentine in there that you can drive through, but it also acts as a waste bunker, and it truly improved the hole and created a very memorable experience. We doubled the size of greens. The original greens were 6,000, 7,000 square feet. Our smallest green now is 11,000. Our largest green, 17,000 square feet. We doubled the size of tees. We strengthened the bunker. And we added length wherever we could. But more importantly, we started studying the golf course for player crowd control and eliminated those bottleneck areas, because we made a commitment to start hosting tournaments. And in this picture, you can see 9 and 18 green, where we pulled them down towards the lake. We made space to build that pavilion in the background, pushed 10 tees to the right so that we could have that corporate hospitality structure built along the 18th hole. This year, we had 4 televised tournaments. Singapore Open with a really good winner with Sergio Garcia, followed by... Well, actually, the Singapore Open's also Open Championship qualifier, followed by the inaugural Women's Amateur Asia Pacific. This was the week before the HSBC World Women's Championship. And in Thailand's Athaya Thitakul won, 15 years old. She played the next week in the HSBC. She finished 8th. She got to play in 2 of LPGA's majors. She won the Canadian Amateur Open just a couple months ago. She's going to be a superstar. This gave her the chance as an amateur to start playing on the world stage. The following week, we had the HSBC World Women's Champions with Michelle Wee winning, doing a Tiger Woods fist pump after she sunk a 65-foot putt, and she dominated. LPGA never dominates BBC. LPGA never dominates ESPN. But she did. She dominated these, plus the Golf Channel, for a week, all because of her stature in golf and in life. And what does this do for golf? What does it do for tourism? What does it do for our city? These are all fantastic things when you make a commitment to tournament golf. And then 3 weeks ago, we had the Asian Amateur Pacific event with a great winner from Japan, Takumi, who gets to join his countryman, Hideki. Hideki won the event twice and is now, what did we hear earlier, world 13. I think he went all the way to world number 5 at one point. Another great platform to grow amateur golf. Takumi gets to play in the 219 Masters as a amateur and the Open Championship. We're lucky we have an owner that sees the need to invest in us and invest in equipment. But I can say that no matter what equipment we buy, no matter what software we get, they're only as good as the men and women of Sentosa, because it's really them, it's their commitment that really makes the property what it is today. This is it's kind of an outdated picture, but this is a picture of our equipment fleet that they've invested in. And my apologies, because it's a little larger than this now, but these are just some of the things that helped us acquire in order to maintain the facility. Sub-Air, as most people know it, as a moisture removal tool, it doesn't get enough credit for what we use, how we use it, and what it does. We run it every hour for 10 minutes. It pulls the gases out, pulls oxygen into the root zone, helps keep resetting the plant. We have wireless soil sensors in our greens that give us this information on these dashboards that run in a cloud of what the soil temperature, water, the moisture is, the salinity of the green. We have the fans. And a good story about the fans. You know, a lot of people will walk up to me and say, are these to dry the greens out? They have nothing to do with drying. It's just air movement over the top. We had a green not feeling well, and it was surrounded by two other greens. And it was in this steep decline. And really, I couldn't figure out why, because we're getting testing data back, and the tissue test didn't point to any problem. The disease test didn't point to any problem. But I happened to notice on that dashboard that the green was 10 degrees hotter Fahrenheit than the two other greens next to it. So we pulled in a mobile fan. We came back a couple hours later, looked at the app, and with just air movement over the top, it leveled the temperature out to the green. In a couple of weeks, the green improved. It didn't take NPK. It didn't take a fungicide. It was just environmental. It was just a tool to help us improve our environmental conditions. We've upgraded every sprinkler head on our golf courses to this new Infinity head. The Infinity head, you can take the top off, the wire splice, the solenoid is right there in the head. You no longer have to dig it up to go to work on it. We upgraded the software and our pedestal package, and we went to single head control. Single head control. Why is that important? Well, most facilities, one station turns on two heads or three heads, right? So this is all the heads on one golf course. So single head control, what it allows us to do is in a normal irrigation system, when you're three heads and you want to run a 7-minute cycle tonight, everything's at 7 minutes. You have really no choice. But in single head control, we can put 7 minutes on the high spot, maybe 2 minutes, 30 seconds in the low spot, and we can run it to the second because the new software we have is so intelligent, it runs to the second rather than the minutes. And when we run that cycle, we've no longer overwatered the fairways, and we've presented the golf course in a way where it's preserved. But it helped us save 40% of our water resources. Just think about how much that helps you save in your water, but it also helps save the energy because we're not running those big pumps as much and all night long. We invested in an intelligent fertigation system. Lets us do four things at the same time. It monitors the water and lets us buffer the pH. It lets us put iron, a wetting agent, and a fertility package in it. It's intelligent enough that it operates with our software, our irrigation software. We can ramp it up or ramp it down on different parts of the golf course, and it's always monitoring the pH. So if something happens, it rains and the pH adjusts, it adjusts automatically. We don't have to do anything to it. It also runs in a cloud where we can adjust it from anywhere in the world. We have 5 weather stations on the golf course. This particular one has little bubbles on it, and it's always measuring low light. We get a lot of low light days in Asia. And so low light, we're able to use intelligent, intuitive information to adjust our facilities rather than being reactive. We maintain like they're greens. Height of trees is 3 mm. When we went through the renovation, we built them just like our greens so that we could do this. So when you arrive, you know you've arrived. We make sure that the player walkways and all the little details are straight. If you're going to do them, they have to be presentable, like it's a tournament. We use all this technology to try and help improve our turf management. And if you use it to your advantage, this is possible. And this is what you need if you're going to maintain green speeds at 10 plus 365 days a year. Our environmental strategy. We launched this Keep It Green campaign in January, and it was really a campaign that we launched to promote and grow the youth of golf and awareness for our sustainability practices. We put some herb gardens around our clubhouse, and this is Vernon, my captain, who's here with me, and Otto Weeble, one of Singapore's most decorated chefs, helping us launch the herb garden. Our culinary team uses it in the things that we use around the club. We added drinking stations around the course and took out plastic water bottles. I thought this was going to be extremely controversial, but it ended up being something that was very positive. We no longer throw 150,000 plastic bottles away a year. You can bring your own container and fill it up on your own. We got so much attention for this. I had no idea that we'd get this kind of attention, but during one of golf's biggest events of the year, we're getting we're getting things about Sentosa loses its bottle and strengthens its commitment for the environment. We looked at all the plastics and things in the club, and we're changing them to biodegradable plastics, and we remove straws from our remove straws from our GT area. We've added carbons to our agronomy program. There's a lot of different carbons out there, but carbons have helped us reduce some of our fungicide applications up to 70%. We're colonizing bees on the corners of our property where we don't really use it for golf. And for those of you who follow what's happening with bees worldwide, bee population's down 70%. Scientists say when the bees go, it's the beginning of the end of the world. So we're adding bee colonies in places where we don't really use the property. We're improving the plant food. And these are some stingless bees that are found in Singapore at Fort Canning Park that we're targeting. We've upgraded our clubhouse. We added a new AC system and a new hot water boiler system. And we went after the most energy efficient systems that we could find. Didn't matter what it cost, we got the best we could. We then knocked on the door of BCA and they made us a platinum green mark. We're the only platinum green mark club in Singapore. There's no city club, nobody else is platinum green mark. We feel it's our responsibility to grow the game of golf because Asia is the growth center. But we don't feel like we feel like there's more that needs to be done in agronomy. So we run a volunteer superintendent program during the week of our big tournaments. We get about 70 superintendents that will come from around the world. They'll help us set the golf course up in the morning. We'll feed them breakfast, and then we fly in speakers to talk about really important topics. So we send them home, and hopefully they've learned something from the event that they spent with us the week to take back to their golf course and produce better conditions. We let our superintendents select the volunteer of the week, and then we send them to the Open Championship. So he can work the golf's biggest event on the biggest stage there is. And 2 years ago, Min and Chai from the Banyan Club, who we just heard of a few minutes ago, got to go 2 weeks to the Open Championship and work the biggest stage. We're the home of the Asian Tour, and we're the home of the RNA, the biggest organization in golf that governs the rules of golf. I guess I'll close with this picture, if it'll go to it, of another club that I aspire. I can't say I aspire to be like, because I don't think anybody can be like them. But those of you who don't recognize what this picture is, this is another club, not that long ago, it was in the 60s, early 70s, that wanted to be the best. And this is what they look like today. Thank you.